There's a high skill level brought to this country. We like it, and they contribute, and they live here, most of them live here fairly happily. Apart from anything else, it's just good to open up your eyes to the way other people live. Look, Michael just stated earlier on at the start, family came here in 1906. Must have liked it, eh? It's all here.
Well, the weather, it was the weather that was the last year, yeah. And look what we've done for years. Fish and chips, pizzas, ice cream, pastas. So you've all benefited from us coming over here. Poor farmers as we were from the start.
That's a great point, I think.
Martin, do you have anything you want to say, or not? Not quite right. Another question down here. This lady down the front.
Hi, my name's Elizabeth Carnahan, and I'm an immigrant. I've been in Scotland for 15 years. I run a small business in Longcroft. We sell cosmetic ingredients to people who make their own toiletries, soaps, lotions, that sort of thing. And we export. About 60% of what we do is export. And so, for me, the central issue in all of this is continued membership of the single market and access to trade in Europe. We have 10 employees that rely on it. We have distributors in most of the European countries who also rely on it. And it's quite scary not knowing what's going to happen. If I can't continue to trade in Europe the way that I do now, I'll be out of business and people will lose their jobs. And as the sole supporter of my family, obviously, it's a lot to terrify me. So I know there's probably no question that you can answer tonight because no one knows. But I hope that you will take this forward and please make it known that it's an important issue.
Well, I can make a comment on that, and some of the briefings that were received and expressed concerns from the Federation of Small Businesses expressed quite a lot of concerns from the survey that they carried out. And it went from 40% believe that Brexit would either have a slightly negative or a very negative impact on their future investment plans. And that's felt right across the whole country. And if you're a small business and you're trying to build up and you're trying to export, it might be quite good at the moment, that's what the thing you said, because the pound is devalued. You know, it's a bit easier for people to buy over, but it's more difficult to buy things back in again. So it works two ways. But again, keep going back to the same thing, it's extremely difficult to predict what's going to happen. I would imagine that if you've got a business in Europe and you're dealing with people that are your neighbours, and then suddenly someone decides that they're not wanting to be part of that European family, I think we'll probably start to look at their own people a bit more. In fact, I think the Italian president was speaking about that this morning when he said, oh, we'll still be your friends. I don't know what he meant by that, but basically it means that he's leaning up towards what the biggest export nation is, which is the rest of Europe.
Okay. Is that all right? Is that okay for you? Question up there?
It's more of a statement actually than a question. With regards to Scotland's place in the negotiations, I think it's blatantly obvious that Scotland's interests are irrelevant. 62% voted to remain. What can be gained from it really at the end of the day? Is anybody actually going to listen to what Scotland wants at all?
Well, I think we're fortunate in Scotland to have Nicola Sturgeon as our First Minister. I think we're very fortunate in having Mike Russell there to fight their case at the top level. I think there are more people than you think that are against the whole Brexit movement. I know the financial institutions are now threatening to leave, you know, they were relocating to Europe. So I would think that these people would have an impact on maybe the way in which this government eventually decides to or not to trigger Article 50. But I'm absolutely sure that Scotland will be listened to. Whether they're listened to and then action is taken on that, they would country have different ways of doing things. Whether it ends up in the judging board of a federal state or an independent country, where we share dependency in foreign affairs, I don't know where we're going to go. But there's one thing for sure, it's broken at the moment. And there are vast areas in which this thing ever on there. The whole of London voted to stay, and it's a huge financial centre. And these people are beginning to leave already. Goldman Sachs are relocating. JP Morgan, BlackRock are all going to move into their bases in Europe. The financial consequences of that are staggering. But maybe if we're independent, I'm not going to get the budget.
Yeah, no, just a little bit of your muscle here. Right, okay. Do I have any other comment or question? There's one up here. Here's my mic. Is there another one?
Hi there, I was trying to ask, thinking back to the independence referendum in 2014, many no voters were influenced by the suggestion that, I guess, vote would be too great a risk to Scotland's finances. In the wake of the Brexit vote, if the prospect of Scotland being dragged out of the EU against their will not apply a risk to our financial status and the potential risk people believed in that referendum?
I
appreciate there's no definitive answer to that.
That's the point I have, and I've been connected to try what people speaking to that are concerned about. I mean, I've written through the place of the Ballander Institute, and they published a summary of their work and all the concerns that they have, and they're a huge and well-respected institute. But the two referendums, I think, forced out to do them. That's all I have to say in the matter. I'm coming back in the budget for anything, Michael, but I think we've got a full shot. Does that answer your question?
Okay. Elaine?
Sorry, my name's Elaine, and I'm just a little bit interested myself. I was just reading the Times this afternoon that Brexit is going to require an extra 500 civil servants in Whitehall, and this is going to cost the taxpayer approximately £65 million per annum on recruitment of civil servants and lawyers in order to implement Brexit, and this includes approximately 30 additional lawyers, paid at rates of around £900 per hour for the lawyers and £1,000 per day for the management consultants. So we know that Brexit's taking employment somewhere. But as my friends have just pointed out to me, Nissan has now decided that they're not going to produce a new vehicle in England. So there are immediately 400 people with Nissan who've possibly voted themselves out of a job. And as you said, banking, airlines, travel companies, very many more are setting up their new aircraft, their new hotels, their new management banking facilities outside of the UK because of Brexit. For me, I think independence is the only lever that we've got at the moment to give Westminster the push that it needs to consider. They also be changing their mind. I would rather see England back in Europe, but no matter how nostalgic I feel for Britain, I think independence is the only option.
Yeah, but could I mindful that what we're trying to keep this as apolitical as possible, please. I mean, and we really want to hear people's concerns about the effect that the decision to leave Europe will have on people from their lives.
What I can say is that there's 17,000 articles, I believe, to be gone through, so. If I was here, if you're a lawyer, I would find a job in London at the moment. But it's particularly difficult to pursue anything of clean of thought in a logical manner in the way you go forward with this. You get to the stage you're thinking, are they actually going to go ahead with this or not? So, there are too many unanswered questions in that matter, Wayne, but I know that for a fact there are people within all parts of all parties down in Westminster are extremely concerned about that, not just the pre-Brexit years ago, seemed to get confronted with people in all parts of the sides of the spectrum in politics, just seriously worried about this. And I think that's because Osborne came out and said, "Why did you elect him and vote him?" I think he spoke for a lot of people. I wish he'd maybe been more active before it.
Do you have another question for you?
Yeah, thanks. My name is Brian McCabe. I'm one of the local councillors. I'm actually a representative of any bank vault board, which is the same board that John used to represent before he was elected to Westminster. I'd just like to illustrate a couple of points. Personal experience. Very few companies here runs a small business. I'm very aware of that. Is having a detrimental effect on our business. It's not the fact that we're not out of Europe or we're not in Europe, it's just this total uncertainty. We made a decision as a country or a United Kingdom country element of joint. We didn't vote for it, but let's not go into that. But the United Kingdom made this decision, the decision was made, let's move on. It's the uncertainty which is crucifying small businesses. My daughter is a director in a they sell designer clothes. They import from Italy. They go across to Italy to buy Armani and Hugo Boss stuff and whatever. And within 1 day, a purchase that they had made actually increased by £18,000 overnight because the pound had fallen so much against the euro. That's just personal impacts that have happened to small businesses. That's two small businesses that I know that have been severely damaged by this uncertainty. It's interesting to you say, John, that maybe there are reservations about will we actually trigger Article 50. You mentioned we may be having this High Court hearing, whether it should be the Prime Minister who makes a decision or whether it should be back to Parliament. I think it's fundamental. But I think you also just highlighted that there is this serious concern that maybe we don't want to come out of Europe, maybe we shouldn't want to come out of Europe, and there could be the potential that we could change it. Other impacts that it has is things like the European Court of Human Rights. Our human rights are going to be affected because a Westminster government is looking to introduce a Bill of Rights for us to do away with European human rights. Now, I personally have had experience of being affected by the European human rights law, so I don't want to see that changed. There's all sorts of things as well that your council does. We have to use European procurement law whenever we engage any services. Procurement law, you may not understand what it really is, but basically it was devised to prevent people like the mafia in Italy running contracts and whatever. There had to be an opening and transparency to how we do things. So we need these type of laws. If we exit using the Brexit and we come out of Europe, we then have to disentangle all of these laws and rules and regulations. That's not going to happen overnight. We don't just come out of Europe and that's the end of it. It's a 2-year process once you trigger it. So even if we take a year then trigger it, it's another 2 years. But even that doesn't extricate everything out of Europe. It's going to go on for another 5 or 10 years. And meanwhile, you and I will be paying for it out of our pockets. So I've got serious concerns that we are actually going to come out. We made the decision, the UK made the decision, so we should be on our way out of it just now. I'm just leading up to a question, basically, and I know that you won't be able to answer it, John, particularly, but it's just to throw something in there. General Deer suggested, what do we do to get out of it? How can we force Westminster to do something? no bad thing. But can we, can the SNP exert an influence with their numbers to agitate in the Westminster Parliament to make them get their backside and be actually doing something, or to be saying, you know, as the thing, well, if you don't get it sorted out, you're not listening to what Scotland's saying, you are forcing us down the route of, as Nicola has already said, you know, this is a game changer and we could be going for another independence referendum. The ball lies, I would suggest, in Westminster's court, but I think it needs, the ball lies there, yeah, but maybe it needs ratified SNP members of Parliament. I don't know. Any thoughts on it, John?
Quite a lot, maybe Martin can answer it as well, but I'll go back to the statement I was making earlier on about the, you know, the big institutions are particularly scared about this. They have big influences. So back to the business thing again, all these institutions and the research thing, they bring highly talented people into our country. They all create jobs, they create wealth in an area. We're in danger of losing all of that because they'll be located somewhere else. These are genuine, real concerns. Everybody that uses your products are in your local area. A lot of these people are coming in from other areas and from other countries. You just need to go about this area and see the amount of people that live here and work here and open up businesses. It's quite astonishing. But as far as Westminster is concerned, I asked Therese Coffey, she's the Undersecretary for Environment and Rural Affairs at the last Environment Audit Committee that I sat on, and the question I asked her was, can you guarantee that you will protect the money that the Scottish agriculture industry received from Europe, so you meet those payments that they were, they're now going to be left, well, no money from, not going to come from Europe? And the answer is the same all the time. You'll have to wait until the autumn statement. You will have to wait until the autumn statement. The autumn statement is going to be on the 23rd of November. And what it will include, I have no idea yet, because I don't think they know themselves. As far as putting pressure on other MPs, I think we've quite good, all of the SNP MPs, including Martin. I think we're all quite good at forcing things on some people to give us an answer. But the difficulty is, you can sit, but I can sit with Mary Green, who's the MP and the chair of the Environment Audit Committee, and I'll get a different answer from her to her person that's sitting in the same committee about what they both think. So it's not just about a political party. We, the one thing we have is we're absolutely certain where we are as a party. Our Westminster party are absolutely convinced that we need to remain in Europe. So that all we can do at the end of the day, you can shout and scream all you like, you can vote, but you can try and wind away your own ideas and try to get people around to hear what you're thinking. And that's so very minded, I think, especially in the north of England. I think some of them are quite minded to come over here in some ways. But maybe Martin can talk a wee bit about that as well, his own experiences. I speak particularly for my own committee. The Environment Audit Committee, I would say, considers a huge amount of environmental issues. It's the way on the, I think I was quite instrumental in getting the microbeads, I don't think you've heard of that. But the microbeads and the nurdles, I think we've been, and Rebecca, my family here, Dr. Rebecca, she's been great, my researcher on all of that. We've driven that through them. The thing about these issues are, the environmental issues are transnational. You know, air and wind and water, they don't recognise any boundaries. So if we come out of Europe and we try to be the world leaders in renewable energy and have nothing to do with that, we'll have no seat at the European table. So how can you work with your European counterparts? These are things that are so valuable. I think for me that climate change is a big issue. I think it's the top priority for the SNP government. Sorry.
The Scottish government puts that first and foremost
that the climate change is the top of their agenda, and I don't think that's happening in Westminster. In fact, I've asked the question to some of the professors I met down there, and they think that to get the environment at the top of the agenda, everything else will start to fall out. But it's not going to be there now because we're going to be here in Europe.
Can I ask, I didn't say one or two words on the human rights issues.
Yeah, but it's been a concern for a long time about the Bill of Rights and the watering down of the powers of the Equality and Human Rights Commission. The budget has been cut year on year to the point where it's become almost ineffective, and you know, they don't have much
do it all the same, but then Martin and Boyd just amended. No, yes, no. Right, microphone there, please. And then, the service question was what?
There was a whole range of points raised there that most of us could cover, but I'll just touch on I think one of the key points. While John, myself and our other colleagues will certainly be agitating to make Scotland's voice heard as much as we can at Westminster, there comes to a fundamental difference, and it's what we perceive as sovereignty lies. And of course, the Scottish historical context, we've always seen sovereignty written in the people. That goes way back to the Declaration of Growth in 1320. There's been court cases that have backed that up in more recent times. That is our concept of sovereignty. The rest of the UK has this view of parliamentary sovereignty, and that's a very different thing. But even there, and this is where this court case that's pending just now in the High Court perhaps becomes unstuck, is that there's a different view as to what parliamentary sovereignty means. Is it sovereignty of Parliament as a whole, as a debating chamber making a decision, or is it the executive legislative sovereignty of the government that's in power? And I suspect that's probably the angle that will come out. It will be top down rather than democratically bottom up. So even within that sovereignty, there's a difference.
Thank you. We've got a question down here. Or a statement from a few.
I'm originally from Slovakia. I think my question is straightforward. What does that mean to me, to my family? Because I'm studying here, so my kids didn't want to return because they don't know Slovak language. We need to return or we may stay here.
What do you think should happen?
I really don't know. It's a very stressful situation for me because I wish to stay here because I have been here more than 10 years.
Yeah.
So my kids, I think they feel like Scottish children or people. So under citizenship costs, I think, more than £1,000 per person.
There's 173,000 nationals resident in Scotland, and I don't know where all the voices are collected by here, but that would be great if we could manage to get a lot of them together. So 173,000 is not a lot of people. But again, I think there's been reassurances given to, I think from Theresa May, that residents that are here would remain here, there's nothing to fear. That's, in fact, I think that's going to be a fact that produced me, it's been said time and time again. I don't think many people believe it.
It's quite difficult, honestly.
It must be terrifying to think that many people. But again, that's one of the reasons why I think in Scotland we have a different set of priorities. I think that this one size fits all doesn't work. Now, and I'm hoping that we will manage to persuade that in situations like this we should be allowed to run our own migration system. They would agree to that. I think that will come back to the top table to how they can manoeuvre that and to be able to stand for Scotland as opposed to being a UK Parliament. I think that's our best chance to work with Scotland.
I'd also like to add to that the concerns that it's also visa fees, residence permit. You're saying if you're here, you're still here. People still have to apply for residence permits and things like that, and that's a cost that is adding on. But it's expected to go up as well. So, visa fees are going up.
In the European Union. I'm a member of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. I'm also active on the Scottish Migrant Network, and I'm more than happy to take anybody's concerns forward to them as well. We also go around, we have our own presentation that I'm happy to bring, give to any groups at all, called Tales of the Unexpected, which is, in essence, a myth-busting exercise on here's the way you think it is, here's the actual, the real facts and figures. Thank you.
That's a very good thing.
I've got a question here, and then there's one up at the back. Yeah. So, can you have a window here, folks?
See, what Adela didn't say was that since Brexit, she decided she wanted to go back to the back in 2 or 3 years. And we asked why she feels since Brexit that she's had a lot of negative comments on her phone, things like that. So, she's really struggling with that one.
Could it hang over our heads until such times as a government is in a position, you know, after another general election, to pull that trigger? For instance, if the people down south who voted for Brexit are not happy that the Conservative government aren't actually, you know, triggering it, they vote for someone like UKIP, who are quite happy to do that. Another question is, if we come out of the EU, will the EU migrants face the same uphill battle that non-EU migrants face? Because at the minute, it's the fact that the government can't implement the measures that they want. They just seem to put pressure on immigrants to make them go back, because it's actually much easier for them to go home than deal with the pressures dealing with the immigration service. For instance, the new law that they've got wherein the immigrants applying for remain in the country have to pay a £500 NHS supplement fee, which I don't actually have a problem with per se, but the fact is none of that money goes to any NHS service at all. It stays at Westminster, it doesn't go anywhere else. And Michael Marson confirmed that, specifically with regards to Scotland. because the British government see it as a reserved matter, even though it's being paid for the NHS, none of that comes to Scotland whatsoever. So will they face the same uphill battle as non-EU immigrants?
Immigration and non-EU immigration barriers that have been put up. One of the things when you look at it,